exam. So the first question that we're going to look at here, question number one, this was actually an equity question. So if you remember this question, just to summarize the facts pretty quickly, Declan here has entered into a contract, an agreement to provide some parts to a second company, which was PIM. And then subsequently, Declan's cost of their raw materials went up. So Declan said, hey, PIM, we're going to have to charge you more. PIM refused to pay the higher price. And now PIM has sued and they're seeking a preliminary injunction. I bolded and underlined that word there for you because as you're reading this, that should have jumped out at you and told you that this is a question about preliminary injunctions. I highlighted some facts that I'm going to come back to and discuss in just a minute. But whether they call this an equity or a civil procedure question doesn't really make a difference. They happen to call this one equity, but we've seen preliminary injunctions tested in both. And as you probably remember from covering equity so far in the course as you're studying, when they test equity, this is the only thing they've ever tested. They've only ever tested preliminary injunctions. So looking at the call of the question, they say, discuss the requirements for obtaining a preliminary injunctive relief under Michigan law and how the court should rule on PIM's motion in light of those requirements. So this seems like two questions here, discuss the requirements and then how should the court rule? But they're really just kind of breaking down the IRAC for you. Discuss the requirements is going to be your rule statement. And then how should the court rule is going to be your analysis. So I'm going to turn to the examiner's analysis. And I've highlighted some portions that I think are really important to include in your answer. So first of all, this information that I've highlighted in yellow at the top, this should be included in your rule statement. So with regard to preliminary injunctions, as I just said a second ago, every single time they've tested equity, they've tested preliminary injunctions. So that means that this is a pretty predictable question. When you have a super predictable question like that, the bar examiners are generally expecting a pretty good answer. In their minds, they're thinking, you've seen this before. You should have practiced this at least once, if not more. You should have seen those examiners' analyses from the old exams, and therefore you should know exactly what to include. So they tend to be pretty picky with what you have in your rule statement for preliminary injunctions. So in class, we talk about the HELP factors, H-E-L-P. That stands for harm, evaluate the risk, the likelihood of prevailing, and public interest. You'll notice that those are all listed here in the second paragraph that I've highlighted in yellow. So you definitely want to list the HELP factors. What I want to point out is that they don't simply state those H-E-L-P words. They do provide a little bit more detail as to what each of those words means. So for the harm element, they say the moving party made the required demonstration of irreparable harm. They don't just say harm and then move on. So this is a good indicator of what they're expecting in this answer. They want you to have this detail provided in your rule statement. So then you'll notice some other information that I've also highlighted in addition to the HELP elements. I highlighted this first paragraph, this portion that says, injunctive relief is an extraordinary remedy that issues only when justice requires, there is no adequate remedy at law, and there exists a real and imminent danger of irreparable injury. This is usually found in most examiners' analyses when they're testing a preliminary injunction. So including some of this additional language is also going to be helpful and is going to lead to an increased score. Furthermore, as we've discussed in class, the court really likes to focus on that first element, that irreparable harm. The Michigan Supreme Court has stated that it is an indispensable requirement. So notice I've also highlighted that information in this third paragraph. This is additional helpful information that's going to make your rule statement really detailed and really complete. So because, like I said, they test preliminary injunctions all the time, they kind of expect you to know that you should include some of these additional things in your rule statement. So a really high score, like a 9 or a 10, isn't just going to have the help elements, but it's going to have this statement about what injunctive relief is. It's going to have this further information about the fact that the irreparable harm is an indispensable requirement, and specifically that the plaintiff has to demonstrate some sort of non-compensable injury for which there is no legal measurement of damages. In other words, money damages, if money damages could remedy the plaintiff's injury, then that is not going to justify a preliminary injunction. So trying to include as much of this detail as possible in your rule statement is the tip number one for this essay. So I'm going to move down to the analysis then that they've included. And you'll notice I highlighted each element in a different color so that I can refer back to the fact pattern here and show you how the colors match up. They did not have these headings in the examiner's analysis. I added these so that you can see that they discuss every single element separately. They go through each of the four help elements and they discuss the facts applicable to each one. So as for this first element, irreparable harm, they told us that this is likely not going to be established because, first of all, it's speculative that the harm will occur at all. And furthermore, there were facts in the fact pattern that told us that there were other options available. In other words, money damages might be able to compensate the plaintiff here. So I've highlighted those particular facts that they refer to with regard to irreparable harm. I'm going to go back up to the fact pattern, and you'll notice it's the blue facts that I've highlighted here. And a couple things in the fact pattern that I want to point out that were key to analyzing this irreparable harm element. This first statement where it says, if Declan were to stop supplying mufflers, I'm focusing in on that word if. Because they said, if something happens, that tells me that the harm is not immediate. This is simply speculative harm. That's going to weigh against the court granting a preliminary injunction. So we're going to talk about the fact in our analysis that this is speculative. Furthermore, they told us that PIM is likely to suffer monetary penalties. So they're going to suffer some sort of legal damage that could be compensated with money. And so that, again, weighs against there being an irreparable harm. Furthermore, in this last paragraph, they told us that PIM has other options other than seeking the preliminary injunction. For instance, they could just pay the price increase, or they could find an alternative parts supplier. So these things all weigh against there being an irreparable harm. Whenever they test preliminary injunctions, irreparable harm tends to be the biggest focus of the analysis. Notice here, compared to some of these other elements, which have a very short paragraph for each one, there's two pretty significant paragraphs discussing the irreparable harm. This is very typical of a preliminary injunction question. And almost every single time they test preliminary injunctions, the preliminary injunction should not be granted, is typically the outcome, which that is the outcome in this case too, that the preliminary injunction should not be granted. This is a very high standard to meet to show that irreparable harm that justifies a preliminary injunction. So I like to think, when in doubt, there's a good chance that they won't grant the injunction. And in this case, in fact, they gave us all those facts that weighed against them granting the injunction because there's no irreparable harm. Now, they did tell us in the answer that the focus of your analysis should be on the first two elements, the irreparable harm and evaluating the risk. So they do go on to analyze the second element, which is to evaluate the risk. And they say here that it's not apparent that the harm to PIM would be outweighed by the potential harm to Declan. And in particular, they gave us a fact here that was found in the fact pattern. Declan presented evidence that it too would suffer financial harm, even potentially forcing it into bankruptcy. So going back up to the fact pattern, I highlighted some of the green here that showed the evaluation of the various risks that Declan would face if the preliminary injunction were granted. and then the risks that Pim would face if the preliminary injunction were not granted. So there's a lot of facts here that could be pulled into that analysis of that second issue. They didn't really have much in their analysis of this issue. I think it could you could definitely expand on this a little more. But as I said, they're really focused on the first issue. So it is definitely more important to have the thorough analysis for the first issue. Additionally, notice here, this purple goes with the third issue, but notice how much information I've highlighted in blue and green. There were a lot of facts in this fact pattern with regard to these first two issues. All of those facts are a really good hint that your analysis should focus on factors 1 and 2. So when you have a lot of facts, if you find yourself not pulling those facts into your answer, there's a good chance that you're missing a good chunk of the analysis. So you want to be sure to utilize as many of those facts as possible. They go on to discuss the third factor, which is the likelihood of success on the merits. This one we didn't have a ton of information to discuss. The underlying claim here was the breach of contract claim. So they're looking at the breach of contract claim. We don't really know a lot about whether or not PIM is likely to succeed on that underlying breach of contract claim. But they did tell us in the fact pattern that Declan at least disputes the claim. So I'll scroll back up and I've highlighted that fact in purple. So we didn't have a lot to work with here, but there was at least something to mention. So they do mention that in the analysis. And then finally, there isn't much again for the public interest. They didn't mention any facts about the public interest in the fact pattern. Nonetheless, they do still address it and they speculate what the public interest could be here. This is tough to do, but this would make it a really outstanding answer to speculate whether the public might have an interest as to whether or not this preliminary injunction is granted or not granted. So some of the most common issues that we saw with this particular question included insufficient detail in the analysis. So simply saying harm is not imminent or this harm could be fixed by money damages and then putting a period and moving on. You want to try to pull as much factual detail into this as you can. Additionally, we saw insufficient detail in the rule statement. Having insufficient detail here also resulted in a deduction in points. What I typically saw with students who receive scores on this question was that if someone had a pretty basic understanding or a decent understanding of preliminary injunctions, they state the help factors, they have a brief analysis of each of the four factors, it usually resulted in about a 7 if the student came to the right conclusion. The really good answers, a 9 or a 10, are where you have this additional detail. The explanation of injunctive relief, the discussion of that first element that requires irreparable harm, all the facts pulled into the discussion of each element, that was what really made some answers stand out as being outstanding. So as I said at the beginning, this is a pretty predictable question, and the examiners, they know that. They know that you should be anticipating something like this. So when that's the case, they tend to be a little harsher in their grading, and they don't give out 9s and 10s if you have a really decent explanation or understanding of the material. Instead, they reserve those 9s and 10s for people who have a really outstanding understanding of the material. Additionally, they did also seem to dock significant points for reaching the wrong conclusion. So as I said, that element of irreparable harm is really hard to meet. And so for students who reach the opposite conclusion and they said a preliminary injunction should be granted, they seem to take some significant points off for that. They really wanted you to understand that this is a very high standard to meet and that this is likely not going to be granted in this particular scenario.